Well, I apologize for the technical difficulties we had this morning and the technical difficulties that we've had this evening. I always like to say technology is both a blessing and a curse. And we've been more on the curse side today, but that's all right. God's good. He's in control. And we're going to keep trying to be faithful. We did want to mention to you collecting money for that. And so if you'd like to support missions in North America through the Annie Armstrong missions offering, you can do that through our church. You can also do that straight through the North American Mission Board website. Our missionaries that we're giving special attention to and prayer for this week are Kent and Elizabeth Slack. So please be in prayer for them. They are North American Mission Board missionaries at the UCCS campus with a ministry there called Christian Challenge. And you can find out how to pray for them. Go to our website on the missions page. And you can learn about how to pray for them and our other missionaries as well. Well, I've been thinking this past week about the very first time I ever gave a talk or a devotional. And I think I was in junior high. I'm guessing it wasn't very polished. But I talked about how the Christian faith is kind of like climbing a mountain. And we talked about how the Bible is our guide. We have a guide for this journey. And tonight I want to return to that theme, that idea of the Bible as our map. And I just want to say thank you to the kiddos who have been sending in pictures. And if you'd like to keep doing that, please do it. You've done a great job. And I'd love for you to draw a picture of someone using the Bible as their map, their guide, the light into our path. And somebody asked me this past week if adults can participate in that as well. And the answer is yes, absolutely. We'd love for adults to send us their artwork. And we will post that as well. I have learned since junior high that the Bible is a map. It is our guide, but it's also a lot more than that. And tonight we're going to look at several of those important characteristics of God's word that encourages us in the journey as sojourners. So I'm going to begin by reading from 1 Peter. I'm going to read 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22. And I'm going to read through chapter 2, verse 3. And this is God's very word. Having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And this word is the good news that was preached to you. So put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Let me pray for us. Father, we're grateful you have spoken to us. Help us better understand what this means, so that we value your word, so that we are changed by your word, and so that we like to share this word with others. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. So I want to point out several characteristics of God's word that we see in this text. And first of all, I want you to see that God's word is true and clear. Look at verse 22 there. He says, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth. The truth is a term he uses synonymously with the Bible. It's also a term that he uses synonymously with the message of the Bible, or what we call the gospel. So if you notice there in verse 22, he calls it the truth. In verse 23, he calls it the word of God. In verse 25, he calls it the word of the Lord. And in verse 25, he also calls it the good news. So the truth is the message of the Bible, which is about how we can be right with God through Jesus Christ because of what Jesus has done for us. So when a person hears that message and believes it, that person is obeying the truth. Now, a lot of people think of the Christian faith as sort of being a secondary truth. It's sort of a religious truth. You know, it's not real truth. It's not true truth. Real truth is mathematics. Real truth is science. And Christianity is kind of more, it's helpful. It's helpful for these people. It may not be helpful for those people. But what we're saying here is it's not just helpful. It's true. It's what Francis Schaeffer called true truth. And if we're saying it is just as true as truth, it is truth. And to disbelieve or disobey God's word is to disbelieve or disobey God himself. And because it's true, we have these important terms we use. We say it is inerrant, which means it contains no errors. We say it is infallible, which means it's hypothetically incapable of containing errors. Why? Because it's God's very word. If you think about a map, a trail guide, you need that map to be accurate. You need it to accurately lead you from point A to point B and to lead you to your final destination. And we are saying God's word is true. We're also saying it is clear. You know, if that map were true, if the map were accurate, but you couldn't read it, you couldn't make sense of it, maybe it's in a different language, it would do you no good. You need it to be true and accurate, but you also need it to be readable and clear. And we're saying the Bible is clear. Look at verse 22 again. He says, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love. When he uses that phrase, for a sincere brotherly love, he's telling us the purpose, the reason we believe the truth, the reason God gave us the truth was for a brotherly love, that we might love each other. And he goes on and he gives us this command. So love one another. And there's one other command in our passage. It's down in chapter 2, verse 2, where he says, long for God's word. So we have two commands in our passage. Love each other and love God's word. And isn't that the perfect summary of the Bible? Love God and love others. It's a clear message. It's a simple message. It's the goal of the Bible. Love God and love others. The reason why people have a hard time understanding the Bible is usually more of a moral issue than an intellectual issue. If a person's willing to try to understand it, willing to give time to it, reading it with the purpose of trying to submit to God, that person can come to understand God's word. It's clear. It's simple. Now, let me explain what I'm not saying. I'm not saying every single thing and every single aspect of the Bible is easy to understand. There are some parts of the Bible, some aspects that are challenging. In fact, Peter actually says that about some of Paul's writings. In 2 Peter 3:16, Peter says some of Paul's writings are actually kind of hard to understand. So if Peter says that about Paul, I think we're safe to say that about some parts of the Bible. But what I'm saying is you may not understand every single aspect, every single reference, but you can understand the general gist of a passage and the general message that the author is communicating, and you can for sure understand the message of the Bible. So let me give you an example. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul makes reference to a baptism for the dead. And, it's kind of bizarre. Well, what is he talking about? And I can imagine somebody reading the Bible for the first time, and they come across this phrase, baptism for the dead, and they say, what is this? What is he saying we're supposed to do this? What does it mean? What did it look like? And how do they do this? And you know, that's okay. It's okay that there's aspects of the Bible, like Paul's reference to baptism for the dead, that we say, I'm not exactly sure what he's talking about here. But here's the point. If you read 1 Corinthians 15 and you study it, you can understand the main point of the chapter. He's talking about resurrection. And he's using this reference of people apparently were baptizing for the dead in that place, in that culture. And he's using that. He's saying, look, you clearly believe in life after death. You're baptizing for the dead. And he says, I'm making the argument there's such thing as resurrection. But Paul's not condoning it. He's not saying you ought to do it or you need to do it. He's just making a passing reference to it. It makes sense that there's references in the Bible that we don't fully understand. It was written a long time ago in a different language, in different cultures. So there's going to be parts of it that we say, I'm not sure I totally understand this aspect, and that's fine. The main point I want to make here is don't spend all your time and all your energy talking about all the little aspects you may not understand or you may disagree with somebody else on their understanding. Don't spend all of your time on that and ignore and miss the clear, obvious message God is giving us in his word and in a particular passage. God wants to make himself known. He has made himself known. He's communicated with us in human language so that we can understand him. And God is capable of communicating in a way we can understand. The clarity of scripture is saying something about God. We believe he's capable of speaking and communicating in such a way that we, his people,
can understand the main message that he's speaking to us. And so I want to encourage you. I'm assuming you read the Bible fairly regularly. That's great. That's wonderful. Keep doing that. But I want to encourage you with a little bit of an exercise. The next time you read the Bible, take a passage of scripture, take a paragraph or a chapter, and try to summarize what you think is the main message of that chapter or that paragraph in one sentence. Try to write it down. I do that every week. I try to figure out what is the point of this passage, because whatever the point of the passage is, that's going to become the point of the sermon, so that you're hearing God's word, not my opinion, not here's what I think. This is God's word. I can say it confidently because I've done the work to figure out what the main point of the passage is. So I encourage you to try that discipline. Take a passage. If you say, I don't know, what passage? We'll take the one we're going to be looking at next Sunday. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 through 12. Read it and read it and read it again until you can summarize in one sentence, write it down, what you think the main point of that passage is. God's word is true and God's word is clear. Secondly, I want you to see that God's word is necessary. It's necessary for conversion. Look at verse 22. He says, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth. This language of purity, purify, is conversion language. We've been washed. We've been washed how? By our obedience to the truth. By hearing the truth of the gospel, and believing it. By hearing it and believing it, we've been washed. Look at verse 23. He says, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. Once again, this language of born again is the language of conversion. We've been spiritually born again through the word of God. And look at the end of verse 25. He says, and this word is the good news that was preached to you. But think about how this works. Someone showed up in these towns and opened their mouths and spoke the message of this book. And the people heard it. And when the people heard it, something happened inside of them. The word of God was implanted in them. He says, like a seed which is imperishable, and it became alive. And they became converted. They were born again because someone spoke this good news to them. Someone spoke the message of this book, which is the greatest news there is. It's the greatest news there is because it's the message about how you can be right with your Creator. You know, there's a lot of good messages, good news we hear throughout our lives. Maybe you hear this, you got accepted into this school. Maybe you hear this good news, you got the job, you got the raise, you got the promotion. Maybe you hear the good news, it's a boy, it's a girl. Before you heard that, maybe you heard the good news, yes, I'll marry you, right? We're pregnant. These are good news messages. Maybe this, the doctor comes out and says, we got the results back and it's negative. You do not have cancer. That's wonderful news. I can't wait for the day when they say, we have the vaccine, we have the medicine for this mess, for this coronavirus. That's going to be good news. It's all good news. There's a lot of good news in our lives, but this right here is the best news. The news of God's word is the news about how you can be right with God. And hearing that message, getting that message, was necessary for your conversion. Someone got that news to you. Someone opened their mouths and spoke that news to you. Maybe it was your parents. Maybe it was your parents taking you to church and you heard it from a Sunday school teacher or a vacation Bible school teacher or a preacher. Maybe it was someone sitting next to you on the plane or a train or a neighbor who opened it up. Or maybe it was just you sitting there in your room reading the Bible. Or maybe it was some combination of all of it. Somehow, God used his word to convert you so you became a born-again Christian. And guess what? God uses his word, and his word is necessary for other people in your life to experience that same conversion. Your children are going to be converted. How? If they're going to be converted, it's going to be through hearing the word of God. If your neighbors, if your friends, if your relatives, your family members are going to be converted and born again and become Christians, it's going to be because they hear the word of God. And the question is, are you going and opening your mouth and speaking the message of God's word so that they might hear it? And they might experience this conversion. There are millions of people in our world right now who do not have access to this book at all. And that's why we want to prioritize missions, and we want to prioritize missions that goes to these unreached people who don't have access to this book, because it's the greatest news there is. And we have it. And we want to go, because if they don't get it, if they don't hear it, if they don't receive it, there is no hope for them being right with God. This is why missions is imperative. This is why we are compelled to go and open our mouths and speak this good news. God's word is necessary for conversion. Third, I want you to see that God's word is living and enduring. Look at verse 23. It says, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. Notice those two words, living and abiding. Let's talk about those separately. First of all, living. God's word is living. What does that mean? It means it's alive, and it means it's life-giving. How is it alive? It's alive because God is alive, and it's his word. It's his spoken word. Now, there's an objective aspect to God's word. It's inscripturated. It's written. It's unchanging. So when we say it's living, we don't mean it's changing. We mean God continues to speak by it, by his inscripturated word. It has an objective aspect to it, but there's also a subjective aspect to it. He calls it a seed. It's like a seed that gets planted and becomes alive in people. It's a supernatural thing that God does that I don't think we fully understand. We know God's involved, we know his spirit is involved, we know the word's involved, and we know preaching is involved, and somehow all of that comes together, and God changes people's hearts through the preaching. But there's a subjective aspect. That's why we pray. Before we read, before we preach, before we study, Lord, help me, illuminate my mind, help me understand and receive it and even want to be conformed to your word. Help me even desire, because left to myself, I'm not. Why we pray before we go speak this word to our friends, our neighbors. What do we pray? Lord, you got to do this. You got to open their eyes and their hearts to receive this. Something supernatural happened. God's word is living. But secondly, I want you to see that it's enduring or abiding. It lasts. It continues. Why? Because God continues. He endures forever and his word endures forever. Look how he quotes Isaiah here. Look at verses 24 and 25. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. We're in a season right now, a season of the year where we're starting to see growth, and flowers and budding, and the grass is turning green, and it's wonderful. Everything about it's wonderful except for the allergy, right? But we know it's just a matter of time. It's going to get cold again, and it's all going to die. In fact, I'm cleaning out the dead grass from last year so I can make room for the new green grass this year. And the cycle just continues. There's a time to live and a time to die. And everything in this world follows that pattern. You and I follow that pattern. A time to live and a time to die. Everything is like that except for God and his word. God and his word endure forever. They are unchanging. They're unconstant. They endure. Think about all the other news and all the other messages we receive. It's constantly changing. It's constantly evolving. I think about the news we're receiving about the coronavirus. It seems like every time I hear a report, it's something new. It's something slightly different. You hear one report, this number of people is going to get it. This number of people is going to die. And then you hear another report. Well, based on this model, this number of people are going to die. You say, well, which one is it? You hear, this is going to be a new hotspot in the U.S. Well, it's no longer going to be a new hotspot. This is when things are going to start to open up. No, really, they're going to start opening up this time. Which one is it? It's hard to keep up with it. And you know what? That makes sense. We don't know. We're humans. We don't have infinite minds trying to figure out. It's a new thing. So it makes sense. There's conflicting reports and constantly changing news. It makes sense. Right? But I just want to make the contrast. Don't miss the point. The point is God's word is not like that at all. God's word is unchanging. It always has been. It is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. It's been the same for thousands of years. Be encouraged by that. So keep up with the news. Try to keep up with it the best you can. If you want, that's fine. That's good. But whatever you do, keep up with God's word. It's the constant. It's the source. It's unchanging. It's where you go to learn about God. It's where you learn
about yourself. You need to know yourself better, go to God's Word. He knows about you better than you know about yourself. It's where you go to find out how to be faithful, to please Him. It's where you go to find out how to be prepared for eternity. Make sure you're giving yourself to God's Word. It's a living and it's enduring. And this brings us to talk fourth and finally, God's Word is necessary for growth. Look at chapter 2, verse 2. He says, like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. He says, you need to be like newborn infants. You need to long for God's Word like it's milk, and you're an infant. Babies crave milk, and there's nothing you can do to stop them. You can't say, just wait 20 more minutes and then we'll feed you. No, they will cry until they get it. They want it and they'll cry until they get it. He's saying, you need to kind of become more like babies and crave God's Word like milk. Now, you know, there's other places in the Bible that say things like you need to move past the milk and you need to move on to food, solid food. And those are making different points, different parts of the Bible. This is making a very clear point. Become like newborn. Newborn infants craving God's Word. Learn to develop a taste for it. We all need it. We need it like we need food. Kind of challenging question to consider. How often do you eat food? I don't ever skip meals. I don't go very long between meals. I like food. I eat food. I eat a lot of food, honestly. Right? I don't skip meals. I'm guessing many of you are like me. You don't skip meals. I don't go very long between feeding. Right? How long do you go between coming under God's Word? How many hours elapse between reading God's Word, studying God's Word? How many days lapse between coming under God's Word and hearing it preached and applied and exposed? We need it. We shouldn't go days and weeks where we're not coming under the Word of God. Jesus says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Notice he says, so that by it you may grow up into salvation. That sounds weird to us because we normally think of salvation as being something that has happened to us in the past. But the Bible talks about salvation as something that's past, present, and future. We have been saved. We are being saved. We will be saved. We will be saved. We have been justified. We are being sanctified. We will be glorified. And here he's talking about sanctification. So he's saying we're growing up into salvation. How? By the Word of God. And notice he says, final phrase of our passage, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. The NIV actually says now that you've tasted, but they take out the word if. It kind of takes out the teeth a little bit. Peter uses the word if. If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. And I don't think he means to cast doubt. He's not saying if, and I don't think you have. He's saying if, and I believe you have. But if you have, there'll be evidence. You'll have a taste for God. You'll have a hunger for God. You'll have a hunger for his word. David said, it's sweeter than honey. It's sweet. I want it. He says here, you'll be like babies craving milk. Now, I want us to consider this question. Why is that? Why would God's word be like something we taste? Why would we experience it like a taste? I mean, isn't it just a book? Isn't it maybe some truths we affirm and some morals that guide us? It's like a map that we follow. But what does it mean to taste it and to long for it? Why does he talk like that? And the answer is because it points us to God who is living. He's a living God, a personal God who we can know. And love, it points us to Jesus, a risen, living Savior. He's not dead. He's not in the tomb. He's alive. And the Bible is his word leading us to him so we can know him. And he knows us. The Bible did not die on the cross for your sins. Jesus did. But the Bible is the word of Jesus telling you that he died for your sins. Telling you what that means, telling you the implications of that, telling you how to live in light of it. And so we hunger for God's word because in it is a life, because in it we come face to face with the living God himself. And so I want to address the person who's watching right now, and I'm guessing this is many of you, and you're saying, I know exactly what you're talking about. I do long for the word of God, and I have tasted that he's good. And if that's you, I want to say amen, right on, way to go. I also want to say, who in your life are you opening up your mouth and sharing this word with so that they can come along and taste that the Lord is good? I want to address the person who's saying, Chris, I believe the Bible is God's word, just like you're saying, but I'm not sure if I really have that experience where I taste it, you know, where it's sweeter than honey, or where I'm a baby craving it. You know, how can I get to that point? And the answer is, you can't conjure up that feeling. You can't make yourself have that feeling. But you can learn, train your mind and train your taste to long for it. I think it'd be kind of like a person who only ate candy all the time. And they went to the doctor, and the doctor said, you got to stop eating candy. You got to stay in mind. I need to do this. The doctor said it, and if I don't do it, it's not going to be good for me in the end. And so initially, they may not really have a taste for the vegetables and the fruit. They may say, I like the candy. But they train their mind. I'm going to do this. I know this is right. I know this is what I need. And over time, after starting to eat those vegetables and taste them, what happens? They start to develop a taste for it. You start craving it. I want the good food. I don't want the candy anymore. The same kind of thing happens with God's word. You train your mind. I need this. God's word tells me I need it. I may not even feel like I need it, but I know I need it. So I'm going to learn how to develop a taste for it so that one day I say, I crave it. It's sweeter than honey. Like a baby craving milk. I need this. I long for it. And I want to address the person who says, you know, I'm not sure I believe that this is God's word. I'm not sure I believe this is true. Aren't there some inaccuracies in there? Aren't there a bunch of things that we don't really understand? And if that's you, I just want to say thank you for tuning in. Thank you for being a part of this time with us. And I just want you to consider, I think deep down you know there is a God. All people intuitively know that. Wouldn't it make sense that he would want to be known? If he created you and he created all of this, doesn't it make sense? It's his way of saying, I want to be known. So I've revealed myself. And wouldn't it make sense that this book, this is the book that has stood the test of time. This is the book that for thousands of years has changed millions of people. And it claims to be God's very word. It claims to be the word of God in a way that no other book does. So at least I want to encourage you to at least take the time and consider, is it possible that there is a God, that he does want to be known, and that he has spoken through this word? And the message of this book at the end of the day is simple. It's a simple message. You're not right with God, but you can be because of what he's done for you through Jesus Christ, his son, who lived and obeyed in order to die and rise again. I hope you'll hear this and obey the truth. I hope you'll hear this and receive the truth and believe it and experience life. Let me close this with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you for so many in our church. We have so many who love your word and crave your word. And I thank you for that. And I do pray that you'll help them to find creative ways to communicate this word with their neighbors and people they know in their family to see more people crave your word. And Father, I pray for the person who says, I believe it's your word, but I haven't really tasted it like this. Lord, I pray that you would give them a taste for it, so that help them train their minds so that they experience it and they can say it is sweeter than honey. And Father, I pray especially for the skeptic who's watching, who has questions. I'm glad they're tuning in. I pray that the enemy would not take that seed, but you would plant that seed, and that you would open their eyes to this truth. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us online. If you do have questions, if you are skeptical, or if you do have questions about what you've heard, contact us. Email us at info@vgbc.org. And we'd love to follow up with you and answer any questions you might have and be as honest and transparent as we can be about your questions. If you have needs that need to be met, ways we can pray for you, let us know. Email us info@vgbc.org. We do have discussion questions that are based on this study. You can find them on the homepage of our website. Just look for discussion questions. And we will plan to see you online next Sunday at 10:45 a.m. We'll see you then.